Decision. It was about 2 years ago that I baptized Eli, and what's kind of funny is their reaction to it is Eli, he's a very serious dude, and Scout, she's been downright giddy the last several days getting ready to do this, and we just pray that you never lose that giddiness for Christ, Scout. Scout, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and he died for the remission of your sins and rose again?
Yes, sir.
I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
What an awesome way to start our morning. That's just awesome. That's awesome. Hey, listen, if that raises any questions for you, if you have any questions about why we do that, why would we go through that? It's really kind of an odd ritual when you think about it. You let somebody dunk you into water. What's that all about? The Bible talks about baptism all through the New Testament. In fact, Jesus himself went to a man named John, a prophet, and said he wanted to be baptized. And John responded the way you and I probably would, like, whoa, wait a minute. You're Jesus? Like, I need to let you baptize me, right? And Jesus said, no, we need to do this to fulfill all righteousness. Pretty powerful statement from Jesus. And then all through the New Testament, when people came to belief in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, they ratified that belief and they responded to that belief in repentance. That means changing the way they'd been living, and in baptism, submitting to this ritual. And so if it raises any questions, we'd love to sit down, just not take our word for it, look through the Bible and see what it says and talk with you about it. But it's a great way for us to begin our day. Hey, if you're a guest this morning, really glad you're here. Thanks for coming out to be with us. We welcome you. And if there's anything we can do for you, I hope you'll let us know. There's a card at the back of the seat in front of you. You can fill that out and indicate any prayer requests. We will be praying those up as early as tomorrow morning. And then just to indicate that if you want it, the whole church to know about it, we'll tell everybody. If you want it just to keep with the staff and elders, we'll keep it just in-house. But just really glad you're here. There's a note in your bulletin about an event called Secret Church. And I want you to watch this video because it's going to tell you a little bit about that secret.
We live in a culture that rejects truth. Relativism is the cry of our day. If you claim to have truth, then you are arrogant. You're narrow-minded. If we're going to cling to this truth, it will separate us from the world. We have been entrusted with truth, with the very words of Almighty God. It has power. It will bear fruit. How can we most effectively proclaim truth in our culture today? Suffice to say at this point that we cannot shirk back from this responsibility. We have the truth of Christ entrusted to us, and we will not be silent with the truth because the truth gives life. And we're going to rise up and be a people who preserve that truth and multiply that truth for the generations that come behind us. It is not going to stop with us.
And we are, Lincoln, you guys want to come on up? And we are a host site for one of those simulcasts on April 21st. We'll be hosting a Secret Church simulcast right here in our facility. So put that on your calendar. There's a note in the bulletin that you can follow along. Hey, we are going to be singing and talking and experiencing this morning the love of God. We're going to be talking about the love of God. Great concept. That's a truth that we'll stand by for the rest of eternity. So let's stand, let's begin singing about that. We're so glad you're here. Thanks for coming out.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise.
Forever God is faithful. You broke into all our fear, all the lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible for you.
There is hope within the fight, in the wars that rage inside. Though the shadows steal the light, your love is my battle cry. The anthem for all my life. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past. You've broken into all our fear, all our lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past. You've broken into all our fear, all our lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible. Oh, nothing is impossible.
I'm in the way, the bright and shining way.
I'm in the glory that way.
Ah.
church said, amen. From 1 John and our text for this morning. Dear friends, let us love one another. For love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. Would you be seated as we take our offering this morning?
No eye has seen, and no ear has heard, and no mind has ever conceived the glorious things that you have prepared for everyone who has believed. You brought us near and you called us your own and made us joint heirs with your Son. How high and how high, how deep and how long, how free and how strong.
Let's have a prayer. God, thank you for your lavish love, far beyond all that we could ever ask or imagine or even comprehend. We're not even sure when we are on that side of eternity if we'll understand it. We're so grateful for it. Thank you for that love, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, before we get into the sermon here, let me ask you to look in the middle of your bulletin. The middle, inside middle section, right at the top up there, says Elder Reconfirmation. We're set up here that we have a group of men who serve as our shepherds or our elders. And our bylaws require that periodically they stand for reconfirmation. And we're entering into that process right now. We want you to do that very prayerfully and thoughtfully. There are a number of different ways you can do that. You can go online, and there's a password in the bulletin. It is case sensitive, so just be aware of that. You can pick up hard copies here and fill them out. They, both online and in hard copy, do require signatures. And then you can drop those off in the boxes out here, in this lobby here, in the lobby downstairs, or bring them by the office. That would be fine, too, any way you want to handle that. Couple of notes here. Two of our elders are not going to stand for reconfirmation. This is their choice, and we honor that. Barry Johnson and Scott Martin are going to be focusing on other priorities right now. I will tell you that both of those men have served extremely well and faithfully, and they and their leadership and care will be missed. They're still going to be a part of our Twickenham church. They're not going anywhere, just focusing on some different priorities, and we bless them in that, although we would look forward to the day when they're able to come back and serve as shepherds again. So they're not standing for reconfirmation. Everybody else is. I do know that Scott Martin is going to be spending more of his time working with His Way, a Christian-based men's recovery program that we support here at Twickenham. In fact, our outreach council, led by Steve Clark, recently they've voted to make a $2,000 contribution to His Way for the Jeff Johnson Memorial. And so we certainly endorse and bless that and are glad to be using our money to support that memorial. But those are the two guys that are not going to be standing for reconfirmation. When you get a chance, drop them a note and let them just know how much we love them and appreciate them. But the rest of the guys will be, so please pay very careful attention to that. If you have any questions about the process, give us a call at the office and we'll be glad to talk about it. Okay? Thank you for paying attention to that. So, I don't know if they do this in Huntsville or not, but at the Atlanta airport, there used to be a group of volunteers. It's been a long time since I was there, but there used to be a group of volunteers who greeted every soldier who came through Hartsfield on his or her way home or on their way to another assignment. And so these people would just set up a desk out in the main concourse where the stairs come up from the gates, and they would welcome every soldier with a hug, and the crowd would get into it and applaud, and some of the soldiers would look embarrassed, and some of them wouldn't quite know what to do with it, and some of them would cry because they were being greeted on their way home from a deployment. And of course, everybody has to come through Atlanta, wherever you're coming from. Because, you know, Delta stands for delivering every living thing through Atlanta, right? You've heard that, right? So these kids would come up and they'd be greeted by these volunteers. It was very, very sweet, very sweet. And a couple of years ago, several years ago now, I think it was during Enduring Freedom, Operation Enduring Freedom, I had to pick up somebody at the airport. So I'm standing up there waiting for the stairs at the Atlanta airport come up from the gate areas, and you wait for your person with everybody else in the world. And so I'm standing there, and this woman next to me says, "My son's coming in today." And I went, "Well, that's awesome. I'm glad." And she said, "He's coming in from Iraq." And I went, "Oh, that's really neat. That's awesome." And she says, "I fixed his favorite meal." And then she told me what his favorite meal was. And then she told me the menu for the next week, what he was going to be having. And then she said, "I got off work today." And she said, "This is his little brother. I got him out of school today." And she was just going on and on with all this information that really was irrelevant to me, you know? So then all of a sudden, and of course, here are all these soldiers coming up the stairs. And, you know, they all look the same, right? Because they get their clothes the same place. And they all got the same haircut. And then one kid comes up there, and this mother breaks through the line like a linebacker on pass rush. And she blows by security and tackles her kid and showers him with kisses, and nobody stopped her, you know, because that you don't stop a mom going to greet her boy coming home from the war. And besides, it wasn't a breach of security. It was a boy being welcomed home by his mother. Really heartwarming story. And it's not unusual, because you really could sit in any airport in the country and just wait and watch and you'll see that event repeated over and over and over. It's normal. It's natural. It's sensible. Completely rational. Completely rational to shower the people. We should have sung this morning. Shower the people you love with love. But God is not like that. God is love. That's how we're finishing the sentence today. God is love, but God is an irrational lover. God's love is completely irrational. There's an odd passage in Exodus 33 where Moses and God have been talking. And then all of a sudden, Moses says, "Show me your glory." And God obliges. God says to Moses, "I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence." And then God adds this strange comment. God says, "I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." And we hear that, and our reaction, I think, is, whoa, God's tough. There are some people who are not going to get any mercy, and there are some people who aren't going to get any compassion, which is just taking that passage, standing there on its own 2 feet. That's kind of an odd way to interpret that, because God didn't say, "I'm not going to show compassion, and I'm not going to show mercy." In fact, he said just the opposite. "I will have mercy, and I will have compassion." You think it's possible that we've heard that the wrong way? I mean, heard one way, it sounds like there are limits on God's love. But it's possible that he was telling Moses just the opposite. "You want to see my glory? Okay, I will show you my glory. But understand this, Moses. There are some people that I'm going to show mercy to that you don't think deserve any mercy. And I'm going to have compassion on people you think have a dose of wrath coming. So get used to it. I'm God and I get to choose whom I love, not you." The reason I think it's possible that's what is going on right there is because historically, God's people, us, have had a hard time loving the people God loves. There's an example of that. Luke chapter 15. Now, maybe you didn't turn to Exodus 33, but you really should open up Luke 15 on your tablet or phone, or open up your Bible to Luke chapter 15. And contrary to a mistake I made some weeks ago, Luke is the third gospel in the New Testament, okay? I know I've gotten that wrong before, but we operate on grace, not law. So, Luke chapter 15. In that chapter, Luke says that the tax collectors and sinners were gathering around Jesus. Tax collectors in those days were crooks. Don't even want to go with where they are today, okay? That's not what we're talking about, right? But in those days, they really were crooks. They would charge more than Caesar required. They would overcharge people for their taxes. They would keep the overcharge and send to Caesar whatever was required. And many of them were very, very wealthy, and they had gotten wealthy on the backs of people who couldn't afford to pay their taxes. They were really abusing people. And then Luke mentions the sinners were also gathering around Jesus. Sinners haven't changed much in the last 2,000 years. Everybody's favorite sin usually involves sex at some point, and so these were likely prostitutes and their patrons. And all of these people were drawn to Jesus, and he was welcoming them. Luke says that when the Pharisees and the teachers of the law saw this, they criticized Jesus for it. Now, the Pharisees were to religious people what Navy SEALs are to average sailors. These were the elite. And the teachers of the law were experts in the Bible. And according to the way they read their Bibles, the Messiah might be many things, but one thing he would not be would be to be tight with tax collectors and sinners. And so they're criticizing Jesus. So Jesus tells them three stories. The first one is about a shepherd who counted 99 sheep when he should have counted 100. So he left the 99 in the open and went out and found the one that was lost and then celebrated the recovery with his friends. Jesus said, in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. And I got to tell you, this morning, this is the first time I've ever had this thought. I don't know if the Lord gave it to me or not. Okay, if it's right, the Lord gave it to me. If it's not, then it probably came from Jody. Okay, here's the thing that occurred to me this morning. Jesus is right regardless of what we think about that, about heaven rejoicing over one sinner more than over 99 righteous people who don't need to repent. My thought was, well, the truth is you probably couldn't find 99 people who don't need to repent, right? So that's what I've... Okay, that obviously hit me a lot harder than it did you. So. I had this moment in my office where it was like, ah! And for you, it's like, yeah. Thank you. A true Israelite in whom is no guile. The rest of you are the lost sheep. So the second story that Jesus tells, this is why we never stray from the notes. The second story Jesus tells is about this woman who counted 9 coins when she should have counted 10. And so she turns the lights on and sweeps the house, and she finally finds her lost coin, and then she calls her friends over to celebrate the recovery. And then Jesus says, I tell you, there will be rejoicing among the angels of heaven with one sinner who repents. And the third story that he tells in Luke 15 is about a father who had 2 sons. And the younger of the two comes to his father and demands his share of the inheritance. And then he runs off to Panama City and he squanders it all in riotous living. Didn't really run off to Panama City, but you get the point. Anyway, the boy runs out of money about the same time the economy nosedives, and he winds up feeding pigs for a living and actually wanting to eat the food he feeds the pigs. That's what a mess his life has become. And so he comes to his senses and he decides he would be better off working as one of his father's farmhands, and he goes home with his tail tucked between his legs. But when his father sees him, he runs to greet him, he kisses him, and generally treats him the way a mother treats her son when he's coming home from the war. He runs to meet him and embraces him. For thousands of years, Christians have heard these stories, and we have concluded that God is like the shepherd with the lost sheep, or the woman with the lost coin, and the father with the lost boy. He loves the lost. And that's true, but I'm beginning to wonder if it's not true enough. God doesn't just love the lost. God loves irrationally. Let me tell you why I say that, but first we should probably talk a little bit about what it means to be lost. Because as soon as a Christian uses that word in regard to people, people get all defensive. They feel all judged. And then they're critical of us because we categorize people as lost or saved, and that's a thing that you shouldn't do. That's intolerant, that's not loving, that's not accepting, that's judgy. Lost has come to be considered, saying somebody is lost has come to be considered a passing of judgment. Like, if you call somebody lost, what you really mean is that they're some kind of spiritual bum, that they're a religious reject, that they're a moral ne'er-do-well. The first thing you should know about the word lost is that the Bible says that that term applies to everybody. Everybody is lost at some point in their lives. Romans 3:23, which is the classic go-to. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The word there, all, in Greek, means exactly the same thing as it does in English. Everybody, at some point, no exceptions. So if you run across somebody who uses the word lost as a kind of judgment against you, then look them in the eye and say, Romans 3:23, bucko, and they'll know what it means. They'll know what it says. And so if everybody is lost, then nobody can cast the first stone or the second or the third stone. So when I say that God loves the lost, I'm not accusing anybody of anything. When Christians say, talk about the fact that God loves the lost, we're not accusing anybody of anything. We're simply acknowledging what is true of all of us. All human beings experience the state of being what the Bible calls lost. And the second thing you need to know about this concept is that it's not a moral judgment against people. To say that somebody is lost is not a moral judgment against that person. It's not a value judgment about that person. Eugene Peterson is my teacher on this concept. He's the one that translated the Message. He's also written some extraordinary books, some profound books. And I forget which book it is, he talks about this concept of lost. But lost is not a word that appears on the left side of a continuum at the extreme opposite of the words best in show. It's not like you're calling one dog a mutt and another dog an AKC registered breed. The word lost is simply a way of talking about the relationship that human beings share with God. It's a theological assessment, not a moral or a value assessment. It means the relationship needs some attention. It means that things are broken and that we, the lost, have no means of repairing what is broken. We have no means of restoring what has been corrupted. We have no means of regaining what was lost. God, however, can repair and restore and re-give. We can't. Lost people can sometimes be miserable, wicked, evil, and mean. Or they can be happy, virtuous, good, and kind. At some point, though, no matter where we fall on the spectrum between sinner and saint, we have all been lost. That's what we mean when we're talking about the concept of lost. And when we say God loves the lost. So how do these three stories teach us that God loves irrationally? These stories are called parables. And parables always have a surprise. There's the famous story that Jesus told about the man who went up from Jerusalem to Jericho. And he fell among thieves who robbed him and beat him and left him half dead. Now you remember that, some of you will remember that story very well. If you don't, this guy gets beat up by thieves and a religious leader of the Jews comes by, a priest comes by and sees the man but doesn't help him. And then another religious leader, a Levite, comes by and sees the man but doesn't help him. And then another person comes by and he sees the man and he goes to him and he helps him. Now the surprise in that story is who does the helping. Because in that story, it's a Samaritan. For us, it would be like saying, this guy is on his way from here to Decatur and he has a car wreck and some people come by and strip his car and beat him up. And one of our elders drove by and didn't stop. And then our preacher drove by, and he didn't stop. But a guy named Muhammad did. A Muslim did. That's the surprise in that story. That's what these stories do. They always have a surprise. So what's the surprise in the stories here? Jesus tells about this shepherd who has 99 safe sheep, but one is missing, then Jesus asks, does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And everyone who's hearing that story is thinking, no, that would be dumb. Losing a sheep is the cost of doing business if you're a shepherd. Besides, he probably has a dozen ewes that are a week away from lambing. In 7 days, he's going to have 111 sheep. It's irrational to leave 99 and go after the one. But that's what God did. That's what God does. Because God is love. And God loves irrationally. So Jesus tells about this woman who has this coin collection. And I've read all of the commentary and interpretations of this story that suggest that, well, this was somehow tied to her virginity, or it's kind of like the first century equivalent of a wedding ring. And maybe all of that's true. Maybe that history about the coin collection is true. Or maybe Jesus is telling a story about a crazy old lady who had a coin collection and just wigged out when she lost one. And then when she finds it, she calls all her friends over and serves punch and lady fingers to celebrate. And everybody's thinking, this is a crazy old lady. And Jesus goes, yeah, and that's how God is. He's crazy in the way he loves. And then there's the story about the father with the two boys. And the younger one asks for his inheritance. Even back then, you didn't get an inheritance unless somebody died. So when your son comes to you and says, I'd like my inheritance, please, what he's saying to you essentially is, you're dead to me. And all the people who heard that story are going, that little... But in Jesus' story, the father fills the kid's pockets with money and lets him go. And then when he comes limping up the driveway, he runs out to meet him and he throws a party. That's irrational. But that's how God is. We get the parables wrong sometimes because we think they're about us. And much of the time, they're not. They're about God. But there are a couple of things we can take personally here. And one of those is sort of like what God told Moses. God is going to love whomever God chooses to love. He's going to love you and he's going to love people you and I don't love. He's going to love people you and I don't like. But God is going to be extravagant and unreasonable and irrational in his love for them. And so you and I had better get used to it. The other thing you can take personally here is that whether you want him to or not, God's going to love you. His love for you is not going to be based on your performance. It isn't even going to be based on your love for him. Before you were able to love, and this is that passage that Lincoln read a minute ago before I got up to preach. Before you were able to love, before you were even born, God demonstrated his love for you. In this, Jesus died for us. That's what the whole Jesus thing is about. God unbelievably, lavishly, as we sang a minute ago, extravagantly, irrationally giving himself in love for the lost. What's the most famous verse in the whole Bible? John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, should not be lost forever, but have eternal life. We're going to enter into now a time of reflection where we think about that love. And we're going to do this through another ritual, a ceremony. It's called communion in some churches. It's called the Lord's Supper in some churches. Some call it the Eucharist, the Thanksgiving. We're going to take a small piece of bread and a small cup of wine to remember the body and the blood of Jesus. To remember what God did for us on the cross. You're welcome to participate in this, whether you're a member at Twickenham or not. It's not our job to police that. It's open to all. As we do, I want you to listen to a song. beautiful song that I heard our team working on the other night called The Blood of Jesus Speaks for Me. Not my performance, not yours, not our moral achievements. The blood of Jesus speaks for us. But it doesn't just speak for us, it speaks for God too. It says something about the love God has for us, a love so great he was willing to give up his son. Hear this song, and then Shelby will lead us in prayer for the bread and the cup.
The blood of Jesus speaks for me. Be still my soul, redeeming love. Out of the dust of Calvary is rising to the throne above. There is no vengeance in his cry. While it is finished, fills the sky. Forgiveness is the final plea. The blood of Jesus speaks for me. My heart can barely take it in. He pardons all my guilty stains. Surrender all my shame to him. He breaks the curse of every chain. My sin is great, but greater still, the boundless grace his heart reveals. A mercy deeper than the sea. The blood of Jesus speaks for me. When my accuser makes the claim that I should die for my offense, I point him to that rugged frame where I found life at Christ's expense. See from his hands, his feet, his side, the fountain flowing deep and wide. Oh, he did shout the victory. The blood of Jesus speaks for me. Worthy is the Lamb, Lamb for sinners slain. Jesus, Lord of all, glory to his name. Heaven crying out, let the earth proclaim. Power in the blood, glory to his name. Jesus, oh, let my soul arise and sing. My confidence is not in vain. The one who fights for me is King. His hope, his covenant remain. No condemnation now I dread. Eternal hope is mine instead. His word will stand. I stand redeemed. The blood of Jesus speaks for me. Amazing love, how can it be? The blood of Jesus speaks for me.
Father, we are so thankful that your love is irrational. For we were dead in our sins. We were lost without hope. We were blind without a way. But you didn't leave us there. Because of your great love for us, oh God, being rich in mercy, you made us alive with Christ when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by your grace that we have been saved. And for that, we're thankful. And we remember now, and we celebrate, and we worship, and we eat this bread together, knowing that your love is irrational. And we're thankful for it. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Think about his love.
Think about his goodness. Think about his grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure.
Jesus, we thank you. Jesus, who being in very nature God, you didn't consider equality with God something to be grasped or used to your own advantage, but you made yourself nothing instead. You took on the form of a human being. You are a servant. You're obedient. Obedient even to death on a cross. That is irrational and excessive. And that is your love for us, God. And we're thankful because we don't deserve it. The place we find ourselves, the place of sin, brokenness, and darkness is a place that we have brought ourselves to on our own. But you lift us up from that pit of despair. And you love us. And you take us back. And you shed your blood for us. And we drink the cup now, representing that blood, remembering and celebrating your irrational love. And we thank you that you are alive for us now and are speaking for us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There is love that came for us, humble to a sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness. You rose again victorious. Faithfulness none can through the storm and through the fire. There is truth that sets me free. Jesus Christ, who lives in me. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken, you is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of all. No beginning and no end. You're my hope and my defense. You came to seek and save the lost. You paid you have saved me. It
5K race, and they need volunteers, and they need people to run, and they need donations. They are raising money for Kids to Love organization to build a group home for foster girls. They've been doing this for years. We have supported them for years. So please, downstairs in the lobby this morning, table set up. Lynn Box is the race coordinator. She's very persuasive. She will sign you up for anything that you could help out to do, run, sponsor, or whatever the case may be. So please take note of that. Also, today, Jesse and Shelby. Shelby did communion. Jesse sang on the praise team with us for the last time for the foreseeable future. Who knows what the future holds, but for now, this is their last Sunday with us. There's a special reception to honor them this afternoon for the 6 years that they spent with us. That'll be from 1:30 till 3 in the fellowship hall downstairs. It's just a come and go. We invite you to come and say hi and thank them and bless them on their way. And it just seemed appropriate that as we're together as family today, that we should join together and send them with a blessing on their way as they go from us. This is a sad day and a glad day. We are excited about the possibilities that they have for their future. We're sad to lose them. We're excited about the possibilities that we have for our own future. Let's stand together. Todd White's going to come and say a word and then have that blessing, and we'll be done for the morning.
I want to ask Shelby and Jesse just to come up here with me, if you would, for a moment. It's been 6 years. That's hard for me to believe. When Shelby and Jesse got here, our son, Austin, was just starting his senior year of high school. And that can be a tough transition. He loved Darren and Summer, who were here before. And so there was a little bit of angst as that began. I can tell you, they have had a profound impact on him as a young man. So what I saw firsthand as a parent was the way that Shelby and Jesse just poured into Austin and into all of our teens and continued to do so. He's now graduated from college and has moved off. I can tell you that every time he comes back home for a short period of time in that transition, no matter what he's doing, he makes time to have a meal with Shelby and Jesse and spend a little bit of time catching up with them because they have impacted his life so profoundly. They have an unusual love for teaching God's love to teens, and that has been their heart. We have seen that in the 6 years that they have been here. We know that God will continue to do that in you as you move forward up into the Nashville area and continue to pour into kids for his glory. We're just so grateful for what you have done here. We're sad you're leaving, but we know that God has great plans for you, and we just want to send you off asking him to fulfill that. I'm going to ask you guys just to stand right down here. Anybody that would like to just kind of step forward, this will be our dismissal prayer, but if you'd like to, just kind of surround them. We're going to do this as a family. Let's pray together. Our Father, we're just We're just so thankful for the blessing of relationship that you give us. And we've just been reminded this morning of the extravagant love, the irrational love that you have for us as your children. And Father, we just say thank you for that. We pray that that love would be evident in us as we interact with others, and that you would overflow, Father, in the relationships that we share. We're also thankful that you've done that in the case of Jesse and Shelby and their sweet family. And Father, you have blessed us as a church family through them. And in turn, we have had an opportunity to pour into them. And so now, in your sovereignty, we turn them over to you as they make a transition to be at home with another church. And we pray, Father, that you would bless their ministry. We pray that you would continue to overflow in them as they impact teens and parents and an entire community for the glory of your great name. And so, Father, we just release them under your care and ask your blessing in all that they do. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.